program, but to offer to the town the advantages of a statewide perspective that is concentrating on Main Street 90 efforts. Over the past couple of months, since you formed the committee, May, June, and July, we've had meetings every 2 weeks to first brainstorm a number of issues and concerns within the town. Are we okay? Brainstorm some of the issues and then try to give some form and substance to those ideas that came out in the brainstorming sessions. And there are a number of projects that appeared to us to, as in a brainstorming fashion, to best represent things that the town could initiate, both as single-focused projects and as well long-term projects that might continue through the 1990s. We have a couple that we've begun to give form and substance to, including as priorities, subject to your concurrence or redirection or polishing of some of our ideas, a town center concept. And I think what that really means is that committee members expressed a concern that there appears to be no center of town, and that center geographically that we know about this area where public facilities and major shopping facilities for Cape Elizabeth are located could be better coordinated, perhaps visually, perhaps functionally. And the committee has determined that we should at least explore what could be done to tie together the center of town into this town center concept. I don't think we're talking about major urban renewal activities or major expenditure of monies, but more the visual interpretation of what we have for a center of town and how that might be tied together better. Another project that the committee initially focused on and that we'll be giving some form and substance to is to serve perhaps as a catalyst for the republishing of the collections from Cape Elizabeth. There's been interest expressed by one of the service organizations and also the Cape Elizabeth Historic Preservation Society in republishing that collections of Cape Elizabeth that was published in 1964 and 1965. To date, our efforts have really been focused on finding the copyright holder for the collections of Cape Elizabeth and beginning the process to allow communication to occur. Another priority that the committee has discussed and will be at least looking at the basis for is to the potential for creating in this state the first major recycling effort from a town-wide basis. The Main Street 90 Committee is looking at recycling as an issue, is looking at what other towns are doing, is looking at the state initiatives for recycling efforts, and we will be presenting to the council at least the foundation, the ideas, the homework, if you will, for what recycling could look like and do in Cape Elizabeth. And it's very early in that process. Another priority the Main Street 90 Committee is developing, and it came out of our brainstorming sessions, was the publication of a welcoming booklet for those who are new to the town, giving some of the things that we feel special about the town, potentially including some of the views that we share as being special for those who have been here for quite a while, as well as a lot of other data that is sometimes disjointed and people really have to go a lot of places to find when they move into a community. We see that being as important a resource for those of us who have lived here for many years as for new people coming into the community. And we're beginning to develop the outline and the background and the basis for such a welcoming booklet. We had a number of other projects too, and we find that or a number of other priorities, and we find that other groups are already concentrating on those as we go around to the boards and commissions. And one was to develop a more basis similar to what the library had done a couple of years ago with a exhibition of Cape Elizabeth artifacts. And the thought was that we have no basis or no place where we show the pride that we have in the past as a museum. And in meeting with some of your boards and commissions, we found that others are taking that up at Fort Williams, at Portland Headlight. It makes a lot of sense, and it makes a lot of sense not to duplicate other facilities in town, but maybe coordinate not only the seafaring portion at Portland Headlight, but maybe some of the fishing and farming aspects of this town and the history of the town as well. So we'll be working with other boards and commissions, lending any support that we can and interest in some of the creative people that you've placed on the Main Street 90 committee to help develop those ideas. One idea was to review the memorial and monument for the veterans of the armed forces. We understand the chairman has also indicated that as a priority, and we stand ready to assist in whatever means we can. We've talked about trying to replace the hill that the monument was on, but that seems a little bit out of our scope. So these are some of the ideas that we're working on. The basis of our committee assignments is that subcommittees are being formed within the Main Street 90 committee of three or four people to look at each of these issues. We still have to deal with how far we go with implementation, and we're just beginning to flesh out some of the ideas, and we're struggling with the implementation issue. But in general, we see ourselves as a committee of the council to come back to you and make the recommendations of as a formed committee specifically to look at holes between boards and commissions and make recommendations to you for some of the things that we're beginning to develop. So in summary fashion, that's a quick synopsis of the last 3 months for the Main Street 90 committee. We'd welcome your thoughts on what we're doing, whether we're heading in the right direction. Welcome your thoughts on any priorities that you see could be developed and could be worked on. And we'll be meeting over the next several months to give greater detail to some of our initial priorities and to those priorities that we see the boards and commissions suggesting to us.
Thank you. You have been very active, and you have a very ambitious committee, taken on all of these little different things that you're speaking about.
That's what happens when you put 15 creative people in the same room.
And besides, for old timers, it's still the town center up here, town hall, and up here at the corner. Anybody else got any comments? Yes?
I've been reading the minutes from your meetings with real pleasure, because I think the projects that you've outlined that you're interested in doing are really exciting, and that they are doing exactly what you said. They're filling some gaps that other committees have not addressed. And the town center concept, I think, is something a lot of us have talked about a lot of times, but in the comprehensive planning committee, everybody's talked about it. But so far, nobody has done anything. And I noticed tonight on our agenda, there is a reference in item 25 to the formation of a committee which would look into that area. Would you see yourselves as working with this committee if we do set up such a committee? Or is this a project that you think that the Main Street 90 group could handle on their own?
There are a lot of aspects to a town center concept. Some deal with facilities, some deal with visual impact and effect, some deal with the function of highways coming together with land uses. We're so new at this, having brainstormed the issue and saying, as many other groups have suggested, as you've just indicated, Comprehensive Planning Committee and various comprehensive plans over the years have talked about the town center concept. So beyond it being a brainstormed issue, saying this really needs to be done and no other single group at this point has really brought it to fruition, there it sits as a priority. Tomorrow night at our meeting, and we take one subject per night over every 2 weeks, just to begin the process of spending some good quality time on that subject. Tomorrow night, we'll be talking about the town center concept. I can't answer your question about how we see working with this group, and it depends on your charges to the group that you'd be forming this evening. And it would depend on how you would want us to interface with that group. We're at your call and at your direction. It may be an issue of one of aesthetics and function, and others might, another group or one group together might be dealing with facilities and whether land uses are most appropriate in their present location, whether those be commercial or private or public. So I can't answer your question. We can offer that there's an intense interest in this Main Street 90 committee to give form and substance to the town center concept. To this point in time, we have been considering more visual than functional. And that doesn't mean that we'll stay in that direction, but at least at this point, it does.
Anybody else?
I said this to Dick privately, and I want to say it publicly, how impressed I am with the process that your committee is going through, and would hope that it can continue with the strong process that you're following. I'm very impressed with the outreach that you're doing with other town boards and the fact that you sat down and started with brainstorming where everything was a valid idea. I know that works real well, and I think it's proven so in your case. Kudos to you.
Thank you very much. That's what happens when you put 1,500 people together.
We'll be careful with that.
Yes, I just wanted to comment that I think what you're saying about the idea of community spirit looking to the past, which I see that you've handled well, but I also like, and I just want to emphasize, and you can bring it to the other committee members in terms of my perspective, thinking about the future too. I think that's really important. When you say that about recycling, some research that you can do, or maybe be the catalyst to really get us going and become on the forefront of that, it's another thing that is near and dear to the hearts of a lot of counselors. As you know, how many items come before us, we don't always have the time to research as we'd really like, and I know a lot of us would like to have pushed harder on recycling. Any help that you can give us along those lines, I think, could be a real lasting contribution that your group could be incredibly proud of if you really helped to kick it off, you know, something that can benefit generations to come. So I thoroughly hope that when that evening comes up that you keep going with that idea, because that's another lasting contribution I think you can make to us.
Those are wonderful words, and I will take those back to the Main Street 90 committee tomorrow night and relay those to them. The recycling effort has received an intense amount of interest as well.
Yeah, great.
Anybody else? Yes.
Just one more comment. On the Welcoming to Cape Elizabeth booklet that you're considering, I think that is a fantastic idea. And also, I remember reading it in some of your minutes that you're also considering honoring volunteers and the fact that volunteerism is such a big part of Cape Elizabeth. Thinking if you ever do get to the idea of doing a booklet, if maybe a page or two of that booklet had the application form for people who wanted to volunteer so that people knew coming into town, knew that they were welcome to serve on committees, you know, right from day one if they were interested in doing that. I think it's really important because that's part of what makes our committee so great, I think, is that we have people who have lived in town for a long time participating. We also have people who are brand new who want to share their, interests and expertise with the town. It makes for a really good, healthy mix. So that if you do undertake that as a project, it'd be great if you would consider adding
our
application.
We absolutely will. Sue Rouser is chairing that committee, and we'll be bringing that to the council. And again, we see ourselves more being a catalyst to get the ideas together, to do the homework, as Frank has suggested, to lay the foundation and presenting ideas to the council. And I think that's a nice addition, something that we hadn't yet thought of.
Thank you. Anybody else? All set? Thank you again, Dick. A tremendous job.
Thank you very much,
John. To continue for the year. And like I said, town center is where the town hall is.
We won't change that. And thank you. We will be back.
Okay.
Good night.
Thanks.
Good night.
Next on the agenda is a public hearing for the Good Table liquor license renewal. And I think you all got a copy of the application for you, and I'll ask the clerk to make a Secretaries, do you have any questions?
Everything is in order, and there's nothing that has been changed on this application. Mr. Christopoulos is here if anyone has any questions for him at this time.
Anybody got any questions?
About recipes or about this? Oh, never mind. I can take that up later. Those omelets.
Are you a bartender?
No. It's not a full liquor license here.
I'm just curious if there have been any problems or police calls in the past year for this restaurant?
Go to the manager for that.
The clerk has discussed it with the police department.
No, there has not, and we have checked that out.
Okay, thank you.
Anybody else? So the item, I'll close the public hearing, and we'll go to item 17. Consider approval of renewal of application for the full-time malt finish liquor license for the Good Table.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Yes or no?
In favor, yes.
Thank you.
Did I skip? Oh, sorry. I skipped reports and correspondence. We'll move back and take that out. Anybody got any things? Reports and correspondence?
Things slowed down in the summer.
Gee, I just think so.
That used to take a half an hour.
I just want to say that I attended a function in the Portland City Hall that Northern Utilities put on as far as Citizen Crime Award Ceremony, and we had a candidate from Cape Elizabeth, Mr. LaChance, and the police department had a very brief summary of what he did as far as helping them corner somebody as far as molesting Crescent Beach. And I believe Fort Worth. And so he got an award, and he was very well attended as far as South Pole and Pole, Westbrook. And it's something that Northern Utilities does. And he sent me a thank you for spending the meeting, and if I'd like to read it. That's all. Anybody else got any? Seems I missed that one, and we can skip on to CAP 17. We'll go to item 18. To consider establishing a War Veterans Recognition Committee and take any necessary action. This is one of the projects that I put on as far as my goals, and what I would like to see is a committee established, and you see in your agenda the manager has recommended 9 members. I feel it's a large committee, and my thinking was about 7. I would like to see a memorial in the town somewhere else to the names of all veterans of all wars and what have you, and I'd like to see a committee appointed. Look into that, look in costs, look in places that it could be erected and so on and so forth. Anybody got any comment? Go ahead.
Yes, I was just wondering, looking further along in the agenda, when we have consider referring to the Appointments Committee responsibility for drafting 2 other new committees also. In your thinking, did this kind of follow along the same lines, that this should be somewhat formalized, go to the Appointments Committee to draft up its charges, to decide who'd be on it, et cetera? Is that in your line of thinking?
That's in my line of thinking.
Okay.
And, not so much as draft it up. I think we could have the manager put something together that we can approve at the council meeting.
Mm-hmm. But in other words, in terms of process, following along,
right,
like we have later on.
That's right.
Okay. Because I'm in agreement with that, too, then. Be a good way to go about it.
Mr. Chairman, could you give us quickly the history of, apparently there was some former memorial that was destroyed.
Memorial that was up years back then. 2, 3, 4 along in there, and I don't know just when it did come down, and it was a wooden one, and it was each had a wooden plaque on it, and it was located where the Casco Northern Bank is now, and that hill used to be there, it's right from there, facing Snow Road. And that was taken down because it kind of got a little bit weather beaten and what have you, and it wasn't really made large enough to take care of future veterans. So they put up the memorial, which is in the rock that is stone that is over in the Tonto Mall area there, was put up with no names, and so nobody would be forgotten and what have you, and they have used that, just that one stone, and it's supposed to include all veterans and what have you. And my point that I would like to see, I like that, but I would like to see one with everybody's name on it, if possible. Okay?
Thank you.
Anybody else? Council Green.
I noticed that a recommendation is for the committee to consist of up to 9 citizens. I tend to agree with you, Mr. Chairman, that 7 is probably a good workable number, but I think this wording would allow us to include up to 9 citizens depending on who we have applying. So I would be in favor of retaining the wording that we have in front of us now.
Anybody else? Anyone care to make a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we establish a War Veterans Recognition Committee and refer it to the Appointments Committee for dealing with the applications.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Move your second. Any comment?
Would we, Counselor, would that, in your motion, are you considering the Appointments Committee to also further refine what the charges were? Because I noticed that the manager has underlined twice draft, meaning that I guess he wants further input along the line somewhere. And would you like the Appointments Committee to further refine the charge?
Yes, I think that's appropriate.
I think that's what we should do also. Other than just fill the appointments, I think we should kind of work over the drafts a little bit more, bring it back for approval, at which point it would be sent back to us to fill it with the actual bodies.
Anybody else? Yes.
Have we agreed that there would be up to 7 citizens or 9? Have we made a formal change in the proposed draft?
I left it to 9.
Up to 9.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Any other comment? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? Item 19, to consider an agreement with the Paperless School Department to lease portable classrooms and take any necessary action. I believe the manager's going to carry on.
Yes, actually there are 2 agreements. One is for the portable classroom units in the vicinity of the, between the Lent Building and the Pond Cove Elementary School, and the second is at the middle school. The rates to be paid under the lease agreement are those that would be approved by the State Department of Education. It would be between $7.50 and $8 per square foot. Jenna Greenlaw was reviewing this the other day and noted that the second agreement did indicate the wrong location. It should read to be located at the Capelzabeth Middle School. Currently it reads to be located between the Lent School and the Pond Cove Elementary School. So I would ask that you authorize me to sign this on behalf of the town.
Yes,
Mr. Chairman, I am in favor of us going forward with this. I would request that next year, if possible, we get to review these agreements in June before they lapse.
Anybody else? Anyone care to make a motion?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I move that we authorize the town manager to sign these agreements with the Cape Elizabeth School Department for leasing the portable classrooms.
Second.
Any other comment? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? Item 20, to consider a proposed agreement for the Poland Water District for maintaining sewer pump stations and taking the necessary action. I do the management.
This is something you agreed to during the budget process, subject to the final legal wording, and what you have before you tonight is the final legal wording. What this would do is have the Water District legally responsible for the operation and maintenance of the following pump stations: Tall Pines, which is at the end of Tall Pines Road off Maple Lane, the Mitchell Road Pump Station, which is across from the entrance to Hubstone, the Stonegate Pump Station across from 35 Stonegate, the Oakhurst Pump Station, which is within the dip on Oakhurst Road, Cragmore North Pump Station, which is at the end of Cragmore Drive, Cragmore South Pump Station, which is at 876 Shore Road, the Clifford Pump Station at the end of the Clifford driveway, or the current owner, I'm not sure if it's still Clifford, that's across from St. Albans, a pump station at Birch Knolls, one at the driveway near the Pacious residence, and then finally the Wildwood Pump Station. This, I think, is a very beneficial agreement for the town and for the operation of our pump stations. The Water District has a tremendous amount of expertise in this area. They have backup equipment, they have backup personnel, they have the capability of installing telemetry equipment, which will allow remote reading, so if there is a problem, they will know it very quickly. They do monitor the board where the alarms come in 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I would like to say that, you know, I do think the town personnel who have been doing this have been doing a good job. We simply didn't have the backup that I wish we could have. And when you have someone spending, 20% of their time doing this versus someone who, the people from the district who work at it full time, they do have greater expertise. They're also fully licensed to do this type of work. So I would ask that you authorize me to sign the agreement.
I so move.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Anybody have a comment? Yes, Councilor Greeno.
Mr. Chairman, I guess it's a question to the manager through the chair. In item 6 on the second page of the agreement, it speaks of the town agreeing to compensate the district and to promptly pay all assessments made by the district. I'm wondering what kind of recourse we have if we disagree with any of the assessments.
This is the standard language that's in all of the assessments the Water District gives us for the regular wastewater assessment as well, which this would be incorporated into. The process by state law and by vote of the townspeople of Cape Elizabeth in 1968 is that the district gives us a proposed budget, we review it, take action on it, you approve the budget. It's a situation that you just wouldn't approve the budget and there'd have to be some sort of an agreement. Obviously, funds can't be expended without your authorization.
Okay. What kind of review comments has our town attorney had on this agreement?
He has not had any.
He has
reviewed the agreement and has no problem with it.
Okay. Thank you.
Anybody? Yes, Councilor.
I'm sort of resurrecting a little discussion we had earlier when we realized that the effluent from Wildwood was being pumped to the southern treatment plant instead of the northern treatment plant. Is that still being done, and will the Water District still authorize to have that done? How are we addressing that?
It is currently going into the southern system. The direction of the flow is determined ultimately by the Cape Town Council. As you know from the notes here, that the district is very sensitive that that home rule take precedence, and the flows from that particular pump station will be sent in the direction authorized by the Town Council.
Okay. Councilor
Quigley. Yes, I was a little unclear, perhaps a question to the town manager with respect to why is it that 10 of the proposed pumping stations would have telemetry and the other 5 either have it now or don't, will not have it?
Either they have it now, no, I'm trying to answer the question the wrong way. The reason between some have it and some not depends on the size of the pump station. The ones that do not have asterisks serve one or two homes. The ones with asterisks serve the entire system or whole neighborhoods.
So there'd be a greater danger if there was a problem.
Exactly.
There.
One thing I should mention is the district has already approached all the residents surrounding these pump stations, indicating to expect their trucks in the area, and they did knock on a few doors, and I think have started off on the right foot.
Yes, just to refresh my memory again, to follow up on Councilor Cogshill's question, when the southern plant was designed, was Wildwood planned to go south or north?
What in the specific design allowances, it was designed to go north.
Mm-hmm. So some capacity that otherwise was designed for someone other than Wildwood is being used up by Wildwood, in effect.
You know, that is true, except I think when you look at that next item on the agenda, it shows that we're at such a a low capacity anyway, that, you know, perhaps it may not be a major issue at this point, but
I guess it's a minor issue with me. I'm just trying to understand how we designed a system and went through great pains to design a system and really to try to take everything possible into consideration, and a fairly major complex that wasn't factored in is now flowing in that direction, and I still don't feel comfortable. And maybe it's just because I don't remember the history. If it did come to a vote of the council and we passed it, within that context, maybe I remember it. But now this is the second time that it's bothered me as to why the river is running in that direction, excuse the expression, but what can we do about this? I mean, do other councilors have a comment on it, or is it a concern other than myself? I don't see why it should be going that way. What was the original reason for the switch?
I think the last time it came on the agenda, what I explained was the fact that the operator had done it without my knowledge, but I think very much with the best interest of the citizenry in mind. It reduces the power cost, number one. Second, there had been an odor problem near the vicinity of the intersection of Hubstone and Mitchell Road, and a number of residents near had complained about it, and this alleviated that situation. Those were essentially the reasons.
And so what, it was done by an operator, but it was then later concurred by a vote of the council?
It came up at the last council meeting about 5 or 6 months ago, and you discussed it, and the discussion of it was ended about where we are right now.
Okay, that's what I thought. Thank you.
You didn't really come out with a policy declaration.
Okay. Councilor Matheson.
Michael, when do you expect that Wildwood will turn over that pumping station to the town so that we can turn it over to the water district?
The legal counsel for Wildwood and the town attorney have been discussing that issue. The problem is it's a little bit undetermined whether or not it can be a vote of the condominium association or a vote of the full membership of all those owners in Wildwood. Tom Leahy, the town attorney, seems to feel that it probably should require a vote of the entire membership of Wildwood in order
to. Not everybody belongs to the association?
Everyone does, but it's the question of whether or not the association is empowered to vote this, rather than each and every property owner.
Anybody else?
So you expect that by November 1st?
Yes.
It will be in the possession of the town, and therefore we can turn it over to the district.
Yeah, the Wildwood Association has been more than cooperative. They're very desirous of seeing this happen.
I agree with the letter from Steve Gordon and that the town should negotiate with Wildwood instead of the district and return it over. Do I have a motion?
Yes, I would move that the town accept this noted proposed agreement with the Portland Water District for maintaining the so-noted 10 sewer pump stations.
Second.
Any other comment? All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? Item 21, to consider a report from the town engineer and the town manager on sewer capacity figure in this area. I believe you all got a report in your packet, and this is something that I asked the manager to look into a while back and to get us a report so we could review it. As far as the capacity of the southern sewer pump station and treatment plant, because I feel that the capacity is there and that we shouldn't continue to build houses and put leaching fields in when there's capacity in the sewer to handle the development. And the developer at this time would put the pipes in the ground, and it's something that the town in future years and the wouldn't have to come back and tear the street up and do it, but I think someday it would be done. There's a project on Mitchell Road that comes to my mind, and I push for this. is that the ones on the street, and this is the way the sewer ordinance reads, go into the treatment plant, and the ones in the back have leach fields, and the leach fields are right-handed to the wetlands that we're trying to protect, and I don't think it's good for them to, since your leach fields and the water's going to go somewhere else, down into your wetlands that they're trying to protect, and let the ones up by the street look at their sewer. I think we need to take another hard look at this whole sewer deal and see if we can take care of some of the problems that I feel is a problem. And this is the reason, one reason it's on the agenda. Has anybody else got any comments?
I just have a few questions. In the letter from Bob Hunter to us, it makes a number of statements, one of which is that there's about 100 readiness to serve people. Is that presently the number that are paying the readiness to serve fee?
Correct.
How many over and above that are there fill-in growth that are not at this time paying that, given the grand scheme or the grand design that we kind of painstakingly put together, what number would go over and above that?
That was the one of the reasons why we didn't set up a readiness to serve charge of vacant lots, is it's really impossible to determine that number based on not knowing exactly what lots may have wetlands, which lots might be discounted for other reasons. They may not have the frontage requirement now. It's tough to say. My guess would be in the vicinity of 15 lots, 20. In the southern system.
You think that's the maximum that could potentially have a space down there, over and above the 100 that are now paying?
As I said, it's really impossible to calculate because of overlaying the various ordinances, into the sewer ordinance.
But by far then, the overwhelming majority are already paying, you feel?
That's correct.
And what happens, again, just from a technical point of view, and it may be a little too technical for you to answer, but if we continue to over extend that sewer treatment plant. In other words, we already had 1 month where we went over capacity. If a plant went over capacity due to poor planning on the town father's and mother's parts or whatever, but continued to operate over capacity, what's the downside ecologically of that?
Well, I think you saw the suit this past week filed by the Conservation Law Foundation against the Portland Water District. That's a very similar issue with a much worse problem in Portland Harbor.
So it could cause extensive environmental damage?
It could cause environmental groups to bring suit. Whether or not it would cause extensive environmental damage is a judgment that would need to be determined.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Chairman, following on Frank here, Cape Elizabeth was mentioned in that article as a possible target for a suit. And I wondered, was there any reason for that? Is it just this May bypass that has been?
I think they're totally unaware of it. I think this was a couple of day storm event. I think it was, they were mainly talking about the South Portland plan, of which Cape Elizabeth goes into.
But they mentioned Falmouth and Cape Elizabeth, yeah. And I think Yarmouth?
Well, I think they were probably talking off the top of their heads. There's never, to my knowledge, checked any of the statistics, and I'm not too sure why they'd raise it. They generally have not been communicative. That's not.
Councilor Ammo.
I don't think we have enough history yet to judge upon how much capacity we're going to have at this treatment plant. It hasn't been operating that long. And if, in fact, we go another year and we find that we do have excess capacity, I'd like to have us look at that excess capacity in conjunction with whatever our affordable housing plan is going to be before we jump into allowing any new subdivision or whatever to come online and use the sewer. I think we need to do a lot more thinking and a lot more planning. And I'm not sure that sending this to the Sewer Appeals Board at this time is the right thing to do. I think it's a little premature. I'd like to have a little bit more history on how we're using that facility Before we make any kind of rash judgments as to how any excess capacity could be used. So at this time, I'm not prepared to send this to the Sewer Appeals Board.
Anybody else? No, I just want to point out that I feel it's something that we should be working on and be thinking on, because when it goes to capacity, it's infiltration, and that's the big problem with the plant. You're not getting 100% efficiency out of your investment when you get majority of your capacity is infiltration, and that's what we should be looking at. You haven't got to change the plant. You haven't got to increase the plant. You just got to get rid of this infiltration that's coming into the plant. And when you get a stall like we did and get up to the capacity, I don't think it's the right way of treating sewers. And I think if you talk to the plant operator and what have you, it throws the plant all out of whack when you get that much infiltration. That's where we should be working. And then the capacity would come with the plant. Council Mass.
I would also like an opportunity to think about this in conjunction with the proposed comprehensive plan, the land use plan. And we did have one very dramatic rain event in May. Was it 1988?
1989, May 12th.
89. And I kind of agree with Jane that I understand what your goal is, Mr. Chairman, and I certainly agree with it, but I don't know that we are ready to develop a policy as yet.
Councilor Fogelschmidt.
I was wondering what program or process we're going through now to correct infiltration or diagnosing how serious the problem is in certain areas.
Yeah, there is no exact program at this point. I think, you know, if this was referred to the committee, it would be one thing that they would need to look at. If you look at exactly what happened that storm and reading the report from the town engineer, there were 3 to 4 hours that bypassing was required. You know, I think in a this plant has been in operation since November 11th of 1987. In, you know, about 18 months of service, 24 hours a day, I think 3 to 4 hours of bypasses is a pretty good record. But nonetheless, it does show that there's an infiltration problem and something that ought to be addressed. And, you know, I would hope that it would be, if it was going to be addressed in the southern end, it would also be addressed in the northern end as well.
Can I get just some more engineering background on this very point? All the sewer lines that were put in for the southern system, were they all new sewer lines?
To go into that plant? No.
Mm-hmm. No. So a lot of them were already heading north, and then we switched them, or what?
They went into the old plant.
Oh, they just went into the old
plant? Yeah, Brentwood and Elizabeth Park primarily went into the old sperm treatment plant.
And is that where the infiltration problems are? Obviously, it wouldn't be with the new sewer lines that were laid down then.
There's probably a little bit with the new, but most of it's with the old.
What percentage is old versus new of sewer lines? In that, if you had to look at it system-wide in the south?
About 50-50.
It's my memory that part of the whole Southern Cape sewer project dealt with infiltration in Elizabeth Park, and I don't remember about Brentwood, but especially Elizabeth Park. Was that done?
Yes, one of the contracts during the Southern Cape sewer project was for an infiltration removal program in Elizabeth Park. There was a little bit was looked at in Brentwood, but if I recall, most of the work was in Elizabeth Park based on the infiltration inflow study.
But it was not successful.
It's difficult to say. It's you know, it's a moving target, and you know, maybe it cut down on some infiltration, but I think the numbers show that there's still infiltration out there. There could be an awful lot of it coming from Brentwood, and there wasn't a whole lot down in Brentwood during the Southern Cape construction.
Councilor Hamel.
The reason there wasn't a whole lot done was because we got figures from T.Y. Lynn estimating what the costs of reducing infiltration further would be, and they were astronomical. I think we ought to review that study. There are ways to to reduce the infiltration is extremely expensive, so we chose at that time to expend only a certain amount of funds, which ended up being many millions, to put in the southern sewer. But to deal with the infiltration problem would have cost us an awful lot more money. So I think one thing that we ought to do is to review that study that was done at that time.
Yeah, I think, you know, on that point, a number of communities, including the city of South Portland, are now requiring when a new development comes in that they pay, in essence, an impact fee for the removal of infiltration, and that for every gallon that they are going to put into the system, they have to pay to remove 2 gallons of infiltration. So what you do is you get out that study and you show that, you know, it can be removed. And I think that's one way of dealing with the infiltration problem. Another way, dealing with Councilor Jordan's concern of keep allowing more and more homes that to go on septic systems and to pay for it.
Councilor
Craven. Yeah, I sort of echo Councilor Amaro's concerns about looking closely at this prior infiltration report. I think at the moment, it may be a bit putting the cart before the horse to refer this capacity issue back to the Board of Sewer Appeals. If infiltration now is roughly in the ballpark of 60% of the total, and we're concerned about perhaps adding 10 to 20 new homes on the line each year, infiltration, in my sense, is only going to get worse unless in some way it's stopped. And if it's stopped, I mean, then there's an opportunity to look at an enormous different number of potential homes on the line. So I think at some point we've got to, you know, bite the bullet here with regard to the infiltration problem.
This is my point. You've got to start somewhere, and that's a good place to start is the infiltration. Brentwood Acres, and not picking on Brentwood or any of them, but or even Elizabeth Park, but the pipes are in there. And Elizabeth Park, I think 41 or 42, and they're the shallow clay type, and they could be very, very vulnerable as far as infiltration. And back then, a lot of the drains and what have you was hooked into those sewer lines. And as a fellow told me, he says, I'm only an electrician, but he says, I wired a lot of houses in Brentwood Acres, and he says, and I can tell you where a lot of the pipes went, but they won't believe me if I tell you. And they hooked a lot of those pipes right into the sewer, right? Your drains, your storm drains, and your roof drains, and the drains around the house, I bet you'll find a lot of them just going right into the sewer, and we're down there trying to treat that water. And this is why you're getting such a flux of infiltration when you get a good heavy storm. Now, I bet you some of them storm drains in the street would come pretty close to on them there when you get over into Brentwood Acres. And we need to start somewhere, and I don't think we should sit here and wait and put a committee or put somebody on as far as what it would cost and what it would do as far as correcting the infiltration. I know we've got to study back here a while, and but I think it needs to go even further into Brentwood Acres and not just Elizabeth Park. You'll see the article in the paper of some of the sewers in the city of Portland, because they claim it was 100 years old. Well, they were made out of, you know, the rock and cement and slag type deal. And think of these that are in Elizabeth Park, which I don't know when it was built. That was 41, 42. Go ahead, Councilor Amaro.
I'd like to try a motion. I'd like to move that we acknowledge receipt of this report from the town engineer, and that we workshop this item, review prior reports on infiltration problems, etc., at some future date. And I know we already have a workshop set up for July, but maybe at the next workshop session after that one.
I'll second.
That this be an item on that agenda.
Okay.
Been moved and seconded. Second. Yes. Anybody else have any comments? All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed?
Pretty good try, Jane. Yeah, you're hot today.
Item 22, consider an amendment to the sewer ordinance regarding separated laundry systems and take any necessary action.
Yes, I received a recommendation and a memorandum from Ernie McVeigh, the code enforcement officer, in mid-June. And he has had a number of complaints about the requirement where there are marginal soils in subsurface disposal systems, that we have separate systems for regular wastewater and for gray water, which essentially is laundry waste. A particular problem that's cropped up is the fact that oftentimes a pump is required, and that gets considerably expensive. What he has suggested is that if a pump is required, that we not require the separation of the gray water and the regular wastewater. And I would ask that you refer this to the Board of Sewer Appeals, to the Ordinance Committee for some discussion and review of it.
I so move.
I'll second.
Second. Any comment? I have one comment. And why is it that you don't want to require it, or you don't want, if it's a pump involved?
Because of the expense.
The expense of the pump.
I'll have Ernie prepare some information for the Ordinance Committee exactly explaining what the cost is.
Yeah, I can say right now, environmentally, I don't really understand why this would be proposed, because whether or not there was a pump, the issue is, should we separate the water so that it's more easily managed by the septic systems, especially in marginal conditions? So I certainly have a skeptical eye, but I'll be looking forward to the Ordinances Committee's report back.
Second, all in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? Item 23, consider the acceptance of the conservation land and question way of the Dyer Pond subdivision and take any necessary action. Michael.
The Dyer Pond subdivision was originally approved by the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board last year. For those of you that may not be aware, Dyer Pond is the subdivision that's just recently began construction across from Delano Park Entrance 1. Back in, I believe, November, the Town Council agreed to accept the roads upon their satisfactory completion. Usually at that same time, you would have reviewed the conservation easements for acceptance. However, those were not ready at that point. We did have a conference in my office with the town attorney, with Peter Rand, and with Robert Taylor, the developer, on November 16th, and went over an earlier draft of the easements. There were a number of changes made at the request of Dr. Rand and of the town that was sent to Walter Weber, the attorney for the developer, on December 7th. All of the changes that the town attorney recommended were incorporated, and one additional one, which was simply to change the name of the grantor since the property has since been sold. There are really two deeds that we're looking at. The first is a conservation easement over a 9-acre tract, and you can see that on the first of your two sheets. That's for pedestrian access, wear access, is shown on the plan. The second and shorter of the two easements is for the end of Dyer Pond Road itself, sort of the unfinished portion of the road. You can read in your agreement all the different provisions on that. The town attorney has reviewed both easement deeds and do find them satisfactory, and they are based on the approval of the planning board as well as the comments of the former Conservation Commission chairman when these were reviewed. Bob Taylor, one of the principals and Stonegate Associates, is here to answer any questions you may have and may want to point out a little more graphically to you on the plans exactly where these easements are, how they fit into the more general picture.
Councilor Coughlin.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, due to a possible conflict, I will have to withdraw from discussing and voting on this item.
Everyone agree? Thank you. Go ahead, Councilor.
Well, I'm a little confused Mr. Taylor, about just exactly where this conservation easement is. Is this the dark line on the map that we have?
There.
What's involved here is that there are two easements, and what we're attempting to do is take a part step in a long-range plan of providing conservation easements or grants of conservation land as a part of the development of the approximately 245 acres that we have between Shore and Mitchell Roads. The first step was the 40-odd acres that was given to the town as conservation land as a part of the Stonegate subdivision. The second step is what's before you now, and there's a third step in the future, and I can explain those. My only difficulty is I can't find a place to hang up the plan, so if you don't mind my just spreading it on the floor here and peering over. Wasn't in the long run a part of our development plans other than to be conservation area. We are providing a link to that this way through to the existing Stonegate conservation land. We also have another link that is part of our circulation plan for this whole piece of land, which is the easement shown in red down here. And that is described also in the easement that covers this upland peninsula. The second easement is for a short section of Dyer Pond Road. Dyer Pond Road is to be constructed from Shore Road approximately 1,740 feet into the project. It extends another several hundred feet to the edge of the Dyer Pond property and represents a path that if we were not to develop this, would be of value tying in everything together. So it's more of a temporary nature than a long-term nature. And you'll note that the language in the easement calls for the easement to cease when we give the right-of-way in fee to the town, which we will do at the time the road is completed. That's a thumbnail sketch of a rather complex multi-phase plan. Does anybody have any specific questions?
Bob, could you show on there the property line between Stonegate and Dyer Pond?
Yeah, that's this dark line right here. And this is the actual common line of Dyer Pond and Stonegate project is there to there. We're giving an easement from Stonegate down to this peninsula. We are reserving the ownership of the rest of the land until our development proposal has been approved by the necessary local, state, and federal boards. And at the time that that approval is complete, it's our intent to make a grant to the town of the balance of the area to remain wild.
How much of that area would you say is wetland?
A great deal of it is wet. A great deal of it is vegetatively defined wetlands. Of the area that is being given to the town at this point, approximately 50% is wetlands.
Anybody else got a comment?
Do any of these proposed trails go through wetland, identified wetlands?
Yes, they do.
Could you show me those, please?
Yeah. The link between the Upland Peninsula and the Stonegate Conservation Land is across a defined wetland. And we have made provision in the easement that trail construction in that area be done only in accordance with the terms of the existing wetlands regulation. So it's not an automatic, we give the easement to the town and the town can go right out there and start building a trail. If they want to build a specific trail, they're going to have to go in front of the Conservation Commission and the Planning Board to get the appropriate permissions.
What about the DEP?
If it's an activity that requires the DEP's approval, then them also and the Corps of Engineers, if that's required.
That includes building a bridge. I noticed you mentioned 4-foot bridges.
Yeah.
Do any of the proposed trails fall in areas that would be drainage areas for the subdivision?
This short link here that goes from the Stonegate area to the Upland Peninsula does cross a stream that drains part of Stonegate, as well as up towards the Oakhurst neighborhood and down towards Cranbrook. It does not cross the areas that are subject to flooding by the 25-year storm analysis.
Okay, one of my concerns is whether or not any area of this proposed trail would coincide with areas where drainage from Dyer Pond subdivision would go. If drainage is going off one of the proposed approved lots, I'm sorry.
Yeah. The answer is that there will be what I call sheet flow, just normal overland runoff from distributed rainfall that will cross all of these, and that's just everywhere you are in nature, you have that phenomenon. There is a drainage ditch serving Dyer Pond Road that crosses the easement at that area, and the easement in this area crosses a culvert under Dyer Pond Road at that point.
Okay. Because one of my concerns will remain, with this project, with all forthcoming projects, that it's terrific, it's wonderful that the town be able to receive easements of wetland areas, of areas to remain forever wild. If we do want to make them part of our proposed greenbelt, I'm very concerned that we're intruding upon the wetlands. And if that's the only kind of area that we're being given through easement by developers, then I will remain concerned, because those aren't easily developed anyway. We're taking them off the tax rolls. And I don't want it to be a false impression of giving public access to these areas.
Well, that is why the Conservation Commission and the Planning Board examined the question of access, and why there are specific references into the type and kinds of access that can be provided and maintained for these areas. I will say that the Planning Board and the Conservation Commission did seem quite enthusiastic about this particular plan. In terms of taking land off the tax rolls, in my discussions with the assessor, if the land has limited development value, it has extremely limited assessment. So I don't believe that there is a major assessment impact, particularly when you consider that the open space increases the value of the lots that are being developed, and that sort of is an imputed tax, if you will, for this land.
The deeds refer to a stormwater control weir. Could you show me where that's proposed to be?
That's located right there. And what that is that's a 6-inch high concrete dam across the brook with a V-notch in it. And during a rainfall event, much as we had last May, where you get a lot of rain in a short period of time, the V-notch in the 6-inch high dam isn't sufficiently wide to pass all the flow. So it holds back some of the flow, delays it, if you will. The reason we've incorporated that in this project is that the cumulative effects of development in this drainage basin prior to the existence of the Stonegate and Dyer Pond projects had created a drainage problem in Delano Park. There's a culvert undershore road that has a greater discharge capacity than the stream bed running through Delano Park down to the sea. Rather than choke down on that culvert, what we've done is made use of a short-term storage of water within the wetlands that helps the hydrologic regime of the wetlands, but does not last so long that it adversely affects some of the marginal plants within the wetland.
How would outflow from that weir interface with the proposed trail? Where would it interface, in other words?
There is an existing stream bed that travels like this down the shore road. And in this area here, there's a junction of trails on the Stonegate conservation land that is close to the brook and involves crossing the brook on some existing 12-foot wide paths of stepping stones, basically. 12-inch wide paths of stepping stones. And then down here where the water passes under shore road, you're close to the easement and alongside.
Okay. Thanks.
Any more questions?
Regarding phase two of tonight's proposed easements, can you get back to that a minute and go over again about the temporary nature of this?
The what we are asking the town to accept this evening is a conservation easement, meaning that we will continue to own the land, but we will not develop it in any way, and it will be subject to use restrictions, but it will be available for the use of the town. It is our intent to approach the town when the development plans for the third phase are brought forth to propose an actual outright grant of ownership of the land. Our phased approach is to essentially restrict the uses to conservation type uses at this point, and in a perpetual manner so that there's assurance that it won't be developed in the future. But as a next step, we'll be coming to town and asking them if they would be willing to accept ownership of the land. The reason we aren't doing that at this time is that land use approvals are constantly changing picture because the ordinances and rules and laws are changing, and we would like to complete the development plan for the third phase and obtain our approvals, and at that time make the actual grant when we know that everything is proper and correct.
As it was envisioned with the people that represented the town that kind of worked out this negotiating process, is this envisioned to have public access for recreational purposes for citizens?
Yes, non-motorized, but cross-country skiing, mountain biking in the bicycle sense of mountain biking, walking, riding, that sort of thing.
And then the 9-acre kind of section in the middle, part of that would be crisscrossed with trails, or would there be one trail going through it, or is it just all too wet to use at all? Or?
Okay. No, that's all high and dry, or there's a Y-shaped peninsula, okay, about which we have drawn the lines, and the Y-shaped peninsula is between 4 and 5 acres, and the lines are about 9 acres, and the idea was to get the Y-shaped peninsula into the public domain. But rather than create a very torturous description that was right next to the edge and involved a zillion little short lengths, we were used a little broader brush. That's there for public use. It's development in terms of the creation of recreational trails and that sort of thing. We envision being a longer-term process conducted by the town when it has completed its analysis of the way the green belt is to work and what improvements within the green belt should be a part of the overall green belt plan.
Mm-hmm. Well, that leads to my last question, which would go to Michael. Is this kind of all interlocking with the green belt? I mean, it's hard for us to envision it, just seeing that map that looks partly like the moon and partly like Cape Elizabeth, but is it, Michael? I mean, were you in negotiations?
I was.
Is this going to be leading towards the idea for us to have a place to walk from Fort Williams to Crescent Beach? Yeah.
I was only in on the discussions as far as the language and the legal end and trying to put together what had already been desired by the Planning Board and the Conservation Commission. But to answer your question, yes, it ties in with the overall plan of the Green Belt, which is to link Fort Williams to eventually Lions Field, and then over to the marsh, and then back in several other directions. Now, this is a key piece in the general vicinity, but it's not exactly where the green belt was initially planned.
That's right. If you can imagine Fort Williams as a terminus and Lions Field as another terminus and a chain stretched between them, this represents several links, but not the whole chain. It interacts with other green belt parcels pretty much as follows. There is a, from the condominium project on Canterbury Hills on Route 77, there are conservation easements approaching Columbus Road, which is not far from here. Through the Cranbrook area, there are not pedestrian easements, but there are visual easements. In the area of Hobstone and in the area of Wildwood condominiums, there are pedestrian easements. You would have to, as a part of this, going from this section of the green belt to other sections of the green belt as they exist today, you're going to have to put your foot on pavement. But I don't think that can be avoided in any green belt development because you've got roads that run through the town on a comprehensive network.
But you'd say this aids in the overall goal of it being contiguous so that you
yes.
can go from one area all the way to another.
That's correct.
There's no big blotches in the middle that you could have helped us out with by giving us, which you might want to change your mind tonight or anything.
at this end, we are opposite the fence of Fort Williams on Shore Road. Mm-hmm. And the most westerly and southerly extents of our land is here. And this will be a part of the phase three development.
What it does, though, Frank, is it almost gets you all the way from Shore Road to Mitchell Road.
That's correct. And if you walk on Stonegate Road, it gets you to Mitchell Road.
Who provided us with this map? You?
Yes.
I don't find it very helpful.
Bob, I think if you show the westerly property line of Dyer Pond subdivision down there, help orient us.
The Dyer Pond property is roughly shaped like this.
So that knoll's there.
With a road that comes in like this, dead ends here, but with a 50-foot wide right-of-way carrying on to limit the project for possible future development. The dark line down the middle of that map corresponds to the red.
Okay. But the peninsula that you're talking about, the, what, 9 acres?
That's right up in here.
Is that on this map?
That's off that map. That's on the separate map.
This one?
I can't see. Yes. And that ties in Lot 4 and Lot 3 of Dyer Pond Road.
I think I understand the happiness of the Conservation Commission and the Planning Board with regard to the possible donation of this conservation land. What I'm confused about, and maybe I can echo Councilor Torrey's question earlier, is that, as I understand it, that during the summer, one of the greater aspects of this parcel would be basically visual, whereas in winter, when the water was frozen, then there would be a greater possibility to have this contiguous aspect of cross-country skiing, that sort of thing. But in summers, with regard to an actual trail continuing along, which today is underwater, there would have to be a fair number of permits and a variety of discussions about creating some kind of solution to that being underwater.
Okay. I think you're under a misapprehension here. This brown section of trail that goes from Shore Road to Mitchell Road does not pass through any wetlands areas except for a stream crossing at this point and a stream crossing at this point.
Mm-hmm.
And those are crossings that can be negotiated on foot by stepping stone today. Probably couldn't drive across them if you had a truck, but there are enough stepping stones there you can walk across them today. This link to the peninsula and the peninsula itself are isolated. In periods of high water, you'd have to wear hip boots to get over there. That's why the discussion of the bridge in the plan.
Mm-hmm.
It would also require, or there's also a possibility of a bridge down here, but at this point we are only proposing to give sufficient property rights for a connection in this area. The red down here is all passable at this point.
I'm just a little concerned about the liability of stepping stones with respect to if the town owns those stepping stones and people use that to brown path to get, you know, from Fort Williams to Crescent Beach. And maybe that's a question to refer to the town manager. My confusion about that liability issue, has that been looked at and assessed? If there's no changes that would alter the small stream and the larger stream on the map.
We have liability for everything that we do, including encouraging use of a green belt, which may consist of stepping stones. There is liability. It's, you know, in everything you do, you take certain risk. I think you have to determine whether or not the risk is worth the acceptance.
Regarding the bridge, the proposed bridge of the part where you'd have to wear hip boots, because a lot of people don't take those hiking with them oftentimes, would we be building the bridge? I'm just trying to get basic information. Are you building the bridge? Are we building the bridge?
We are not proposing to build the bridge. And it's not even clear at this point what the town's plan for the Greenbelt is overall. And it may be that out of the detailed plan for the Greenbelt, that a requirement for the bridge will come forth.
Do you, with what your knowledge is regarding this situation, feel that a bridge could be approved? Or would it pass all the requirements, DEP, or is it unlikely? Or maybe Janet, with your professional eye, could tell me.
I'm not going to pretend to be DEP.
Okay. Are we accepting a piece of land that has a chance of a bridge being accepted, or just that it's going to be strictly, we can never get to it in the summer, we can only look at it?
Oh, I think you'd have to take chances with the DEP.
It certainly is an allowed activity under the local regulation.
Yeah. If you're not,
and it's an allowed activity with the Corps of Engineers.
If you're not going to wash silt and soil into the water, mm-hmm. if you're going to do it in such a way so that there isn't siltation or disturbance, I don't see any reason why we wouldn't get a permit.
If the DEP would allow Dyer Pond Road, I wouldn't be surprised if they'd allow a bridge.
Okay, that's the kind of information I'm looking for.
My belief is that the appropriate way to build it would be as simply a plank footbridge supported on wooden posts every few feet,
mm-hmm.
And of sufficient height over the stream so that in a stormwater event, the waters were still below the bridge.
How wide is this stream at this point?
In the middle of the summer, you can walk across it.
Jump across it.
You can step across it.
Yeah, but in spring.
In May, you needed to swim. This is a small drainage basin for 472 acres above Shore Road, and small drainage basins tend to be flashy, which means the flows come quickly and dissipate quickly. I have been out there, and in wet parts of the years, been up to my knees, and in other parts of the years, stepped across it.
But what are we talking for a bridge?
Oh.
6 feet, or?
Yes.
Bob, the way I'm reading the deeds, both the grantor and the holder are entitled to construct wooden footbridges, place boulders, and construct and maintain foot trails. What kind of intentions would the grantor have to do any of those?
At this point, we do not, we have not proposed and do not intend to build any of those. What emerges in the ultimate plan with the third phase development, I think, is a matter of conjecture at this point.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, we have before us item 26 later on this evening, whereby we're going to be looking at draft 16A of the Cape Elizabeth Wetlands Ordinance. In this particular ordinance, which hopefully at some point in the future is going to pass, there is some special note with regard to catwalks and footbridges, item 20, page 5, indicating that special permits would be necessary for critical wetland zones. Perhaps my question goes to the town manager. How complicated, Michael, with respect to the special permitting for a possible footbridge?
The pages 6 and 7 and 8 and 9 reveal the exact criteria for that of the wetlands ordinance. You know, I think any time you need an environmental permit, it's complicated, but reading these regulations, it's not unduly so.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
I just want to say, maybe I'm alone in this, but for this type of very complex and fairly important to the town easement, it might have been helpful to have some of the negotiators from the town side present so that we could understand what some of their thinking was in terms of how we got to this point, what's exciting about it. I don't really expect him to have to really sell it from the town's perspective, and yet I felt it would have been very, very appropriate tonight to have either Peter or someone else that was involved saying to us, answering these questions a lot more straightforward as to why is this a good deal for the town. We're putting you basically through the whole process again. I feel I have to because there's no other way I could vote for it. And I think it would have been extremely helpful for us to either in a workshop session or just have someone here answering questions, be made more aware of all the ramifications behind this before being placed kind of on the spot tonight. So I'm not happy with this process, just to let you know.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I would echo Councilor LaTorre's words exactly, and wonder about the possibility of having either the former chairman of the Conservation Commission and or the former chairman or current chairman of the Planning Board available to fill us in more specifically. It's a huge piece of land. It has a great effect on the Cape, and I think it's a major decision that I'm really not comfortable with regard to my review of the maps that we were given, and some of my confusion still about the future with regard to possible bridging this land to continue a probable continuous pathway.
Anybody else?
I'm curious, Bob, what effect would it have on your project if we postpone a council vote on this item this evening?
I don't believe that it would have a substantial effect on the project if the council were to eventually take the easement in the form as prepared. However, I do have several of these lots under contract subject to the easement language that we have before us, which, as I say, has been a cooperative effort of the Conservation Commission, the Planning Board, Town Manager, Town Attorney, and ourselves. And a change to those easement terms downstream could be difficult, could be impossible. if a lot buyer, after they buy, declines to allow it.
Do you anticipate closing on any of those before the second Monday in August?
Nope. The second Monday in August would be fine.
I think the other problem with it, Mr. Taylor didn't point out, is that the final plan approval by the planning board does already contain this trail system. It is on the plan that's now in the registry. So, you know, I think it's very important that the council fully understand it. And, you know, I understand your desire and the importance of you doing so, but I think, you know, the end result of the discussion will be a better understanding of it. And at this point, it would be extremely difficult to change the actual trail system since the subdivision has received final plan approval and permits from the DEP and the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers.
Nonetheless, Mr. Manager, I'd like to see us table this until the August meeting to have a further discussion regarding our own town people, to explain a little bit more about it and possibly field some questions. And once again, believe me, I believe that you're very generous coming forward and doing this. I don't think you have to do any of it. I think you've probably given in the negotiations, and I hope you don't interpret this anything other than thank you for being generous, but I need to just understand it a little bit more from my side, and I'd like to thus make a motion to table it until the August meeting.
Is that your motion? Do we have a second?
I will second the motion and only say, unfortunately, I will be out of the country at the August meeting. I'll make every effort to discuss the issue with Peter Rand and Alice Rand beforehand and convey my thoughts to the council before a specific presentation.
The move and second to be tabled to the August meeting. All those in favor, raise your hand. 1, 2, 3. All those opposed?
Motion fails.
With one abstaining.
Mr. Chair.
Councilor Emma.
Due to the fact that both the planning board and the conservation committee are recommending these easements, I have every confidence in those two groups, and I think they go over each of these projects so thoroughly that when a recommendation is made to us, I take that very seriously. I agree with Councilor LaTorre that it would have been much more helpful for a representative of each of those groups who have been here tonight to aid in our discussion. However, I have enough confidence in the two committees and their recommendations to move at this point that we accept these two easements as recommended by the planning board.
Second. I'm inclined to agree with what Councilor Arrow just had to say, but we've had the recommendation for the board, and the planning board, I know, has scrutinized that project quite thoroughly, and I have confidence that they, with their agreement, and I could vote in favor, and also the Conservation Commission acts very closely with the planning board, so I don't have any problem with the plan.
I just want to make one last comment. The key to teamwork, as everybody knows, it's not a cliche, is the truth, is communication. If we're a team working with them and us, and now they have given us an assist and we're about to slam dunk, I really want to know where my other teammates are lying in terms of strategy. It's utterly essential. This is critical to the future of the town, something that's very important to me, a trail system, nature walk, etc. And I just don't feel that kind of team, and I just, if it passes, I hope we've learned a lesson from this, because this is not the proper way to have teamwork. I'm just telling you, you've got to know a little bit more about the strategy, because in effect, they are still working for us.
I understand they're working for us.
I want to see us tighten that communication, one link much stronger.
I understand that they're working for us, and I don't think they really have to be sitting here in front or answering a question. If they had any questions for the project, I feel that we would have a letter in writing before us from each one of the group saying that they had a problem with the trail system, they had a problem with this, and to let us know. They must have agreed and voted on it.
That's not enough for me. They're advisors. They're just advisors.
When I received and went over my packet last week, I did have a number of questions, as I'm sure you all can tell from my proceedings this evening about this project. And I did contact the manager and asked him if anybody was going to be present to answer questions from the developer's side. I did not have a problem with the fact that our planning board and our conservation commission was not going to be here tonight. I agree that I do have confidence in them. I did make you go through some hoops this evening to help educate the council, and I think you can understand some of the reasoning behind that. I would hope that I would encourage other counselors to ask people to be present if they want information from them at our meetings. And I'm going to vote in favor of the motion on the floor.
Just say, you know, in the past, a lot of these have come before the council, and there's never been a request for either the Planning Board or Conservation Commission chairman to be present. A number of times they have been here, but most of the time they haven't. But due to the concern of at least two council members, if not three, two who have spoken on it, I'll be happy to in the future, whenever any of these come on the agenda, before you even schedule it on the agenda, to make sure that the chairman of both boards can be here.
Anybody else got any comment? Ready for the vote? Understand the motion?
Mm-hmm.
All those in favor, raise your hand. 4. Those opposed? 4-2 and 1 abstain. Thank you.
Thank you.
Item 24, to consider a report from the Appointments Committee regarding vacancies on the Harbor Commission taking necessary action. I believe Mr. Fino.
The Appointments Committee held interviews from applicants for the Harbor Commission Board. We had a very pleasant evening with the applicants. We feel we have a very well-rounded committee, not only in their experience and where they come from in different issues, but I think also in something Councilor Amrow has mentioned this evening, it's a well-rounded committee in terms of their length of residence in Cape Elizabeth. We have a member who's lived in Cape Elizabeth, I guess, all his life, and another potential member who is quite new in the community. Now, at this time, I'd like to put forth the names of Janet McKay to serve as a Harbor Commissioner until March 1st, 1992. Michael Monroe to serve until March 1st, 1991, and George Knowles to serve until March 1st, 1990.
Second.
Good move, and second. Anybody any comment? Albert?
My only comment is I think that these three choices are superb choices.
I will echo Councillor Creelman's comment. Very impressed.
All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? Raise your hand. Item 25. To consider referring to the Appointments Committee responsibility of drafting charges of family fund and its proposed town center municipal facility committee and take any necessary action. I move the manager.
The purpose of doing this is to give, first of all, the Family Fund Day Committee a little more permanent status. Family Fund Day looks like it's something that's become part of the Cape Elizabeth tradition. And just as the Fort Williams Advisory Committee was first set up on sort of an advisory ad hoc business, and the Arts Council was done as well, it was felt that after a number of years, when they became more established, it was good to bring it more under the wing of the Appointments Committee so that there was better continuity and improved structure. So I'd recommend that you ask the Appointments Committee to look at possibly setting up the Family Fund Day Committee with permanent standing and to draft a charge or even perhaps an ordinance, as many of the other permanent committees are set up, which would govern how the committee would be appointed and what the role of the council would be, et cetera. The second committee under this item is a suggestion to set up a Town Center Municipal Facilities Committee. This Jane Amaro asked a question earlier to Dick Tinsman about what was the feeling of the Main Street 90 committee about working on the town center or having a separate committee. I had about a 1-hour discussion with Dick Tinsman earlier today on this issue, and I think he answered the question very delicately. It is something that, you know, I think it is important for the Appointments Committee to look at, particularly on the town center aspect of it. Do you want the Main Street 90 committee to run with that issue, or to be more or less a brainstorming committee and have another committee that's going to make more specific suggestions that also look at the issue of municipal facilities? The reason the municipal facilities comes into this is we recently received a report on the fire department indicating that once we get a replacement for our ladder truck, which is in a couple of years, it won't fit into our fire station, and we need to address that. That report also suggested closing engine one. Similarly, you authorized in the budget a report this year in our public works facilities. There's also been concern expressed by the chief of police that the police department needs more space. I think all these suggestions are coming forward, and there needs to be a coordinating body, and I think someone that gives an independent look to it. And, you know, I think has been expressed over and over that there's a great deal of confidence in the citizens of this community to be a very diverse group, as was indicated earlier, and to come forward and to recognize the needs of the community. I think the library is an excellent example of that. The town council several years ago appointed a Pond Cove School Annex Committee, and that report, while some resisted it as saying it was infringing on the turf of the library board and other groups, in the end, that they came up with a recommendation, and then working very closely with the library trustees, the present Thomas Memorial Library was united and renovated. So I would really appreciate if the appointments committee would look at this issue, decide if a committee is appropriate, and if so, to decide the numbers of members that should serve on it and where they should be represented. Or I think that the addition to that is to consider further, particularly after taking the views of the Main Street 90 committee at the meeting tomorrow night, to see how much involvement you want from that group. Do you want to solicit members from there to serve on this committee if this committee's decided to be formed, or have a committee of other citizens? That'd be something that could easily go through this process.
Council Master.
I frankly don't like the idea of proliferating committees. I do think we need a separate committee to look at the municipal facilities. That's a technical kind of thing, but I don't see why we can't let the Main Street 90 committee run with the town center concept if they're so creative and innovative and so enthusiastic. I think that they might bring a very fresh look at the situation, and those two things are really not very compatible.
Councilman Creelman.
I'd somewhat agree almost with everything Councilor Masterton just spoke on. I think that I'm most grateful for the input of all of the committees in the town, but I do think that at some point things may get out of hand with regard to the number of committees. If we have a Family Fun Day committee, why not a Memorial Day committee that commemorates a particular day of the year? It just seems to have a standing committee is a bit excessive, as Family Fun Day has really gone, at least in the four that I've attended, relatively smoothly, as long as we can coordinate it with Project Graduation. And I think to lump the two together are really very different sorts of committees. I also echo Nancy's thought that why not wait until the Main Street 90 finishes its story before we perhaps jump the gun and create a Town Center Municipal Facilities Committee.
I was going to also agree with what Councillor Masterton said, that I feel that a Town Center Committee is really premature at this time to develop a committee for that whole concept.
You mean the Town Center or
the concept of the municipal facilities do need to be sort of studied and addressed, and we can do that in sort of a subcommittee perhaps of the Town Council with a few involved department heads or citizens. But an actual Town Center Committee, I think, is premature until we have Main Street 90 give us some input.
Anybody else? Councilor
Latour. I'd like to see the appointment of a Family Fun Day Committee and a Municipal Facilities Committee. I agree with the separation off from the Town Center Committee. Why not let Main Street 90 run with it? They'll come up with some good ideas, maybe be a catalyst. Who knows how far they'll go with it? I didn't like the idea of combining them anyway, but I would like to voice my approval for the formation of the other two committees. So I think it's a very complex thing to look at our facilities, and it should be studied by a formalized committee.
I'm thinking and changing my mind as I think, but I'll talk anyway. Since when does that stop me?
That's like Jeopardy, though. You already hit the button, you know. You've got to give an answer. You've got to give an answer. No, it's all right.
I guess my concern was separating the Town Center and Municipal Facilities Committees into two groups and separating them schedule-wise is that one would be technically oriented and one would be creatively oriented. And contrary to some of the comments I've heard this evening, those two can be very successfully combined if you use good planning and design procedures. And I don't think it's inappropriate to combine them at this point. I would be interested in having the appointments committee talk with Dick Tinsman and representatives perhaps of Main Street 90 and probably the manager and sit down and see if there is a workable solution to having both people from both Main Street 90 committee and a Town Center Facilities Committee work together or have a separation of charges for the two of them in some way. And I think that's worth exploring.
Anybody else? I've just one comment. I think the Municipal Facilities is a committee that should be separated because I think that's a committee that's got to do some deep research and of what the town has happened in the town and what the future should be of the facilities as far as the fire department, police department, and public works. The manager mentioned about in the report about closing 91 station. I would like to say, if anybody's listening from Cape Cod, is that we're not going to close that down without some coverage there. The thought was that if you close it down and you merge with Ward Square in South Pole, and the two companies would run in Cape Cod. South Portland would come into Cape Elizabeth, and Cape Elizabeth would run with South Portland. That's the same way that Scarborough, North Scarborough and South Durham operate. And I think due to the manpower shortage, that should be really good. And I just wanted to clear that up when you just said close it. They might get upset that we're going to pull the trash all around. And they would still have a meeting place there or something, but I just wanted to clear that. I think at the Town Center, I'm in agreement that I think Main Street could go with that and they come up with some ideas. They might even come up with some ideas with the Facilities Committee. Fire Family Funding Committee, it's a toss-up. I think we have so many committees and we pretty much put everybody to work in the town. Keep creating committees, but I think in the past they've had a committee, and if you have a permanent committee, you're thinking more as if it would rotate 3 or 4 a year. Is that the idea? What's the idea of family funding?
It's a couple of things. One is to assure some continuity by having terms expire at different times. There's, you know, the possibility at this point, you know, we already don't have a chairman for next year. There was a suggestion made by one of the committee members this year that everyone should resign and start with a totally new committee. You know, that can be difficult. And the other issue, I think, is one of control. I found that, you know, when you're totally dealing with volunteers and you tell them there's a budget needs to be followed, they're not as quick to follow it as a standing committee would be. We had a number of problems this year with Family Fun Day with an attitude that the budget didn't matter. And I sent the message very clearly back that the budget does matter. And you know, I would feel more comfortable with taking some of the excellent people who are working on Family Fun Day and incorporate them into the appointments committee process and a committee of one that the council can influence direction upon.
What about the committee that Councilor Creeman just brought up a minute ago? We always have to pick up somebody that's interested in it. It's the Memorial Day committee. What's your feelings, James?
I think, you know, as I mentioned, the other committees, it's like so many things, you let them run for a couple of years, see how they go, and then you decide whether or not you want to give them permanent status. As of this point, the Memorial Day committee, you know, did a fine job this year. I think it was, you know, by far the best Memorial Day we've had in a long time. And, you know, I would hope that 2 years from now, the town council might look at that and to give it a more permanent standing. But, you know, just like the Arts Council and some of these others, you know, I think, you know, they earn their wings first, and then you bring them...
Then you fly, right?
Then you fly, yes. Every day.
One thought has occurred that if this were put to a charge to the Appointments Committee, one consideration we might have is having, I don't know what we'd call it, the Celebration Day Committee that could encompass Family Fun Day and Memorial Day.
We've talked about that, and the problem is they're so close within a schedule that it's kind of taxing on the people involved.
You had 15 creative people.
It's difficult with both events so close together.
Yeah.
Why, you made one comment just to clear my mind. Why should all the committee resign this year that it Family Fun Day? Because it was foggy? I thought they'd agree.
I did not make that recommendation or suggestion. It was one of the members of the committee, and my understanding was that the member who suggested it did so on the basis of the thought that things were getting a little stale and needed new blood, that they seemed to be doing it by rote. I don't agree with that view, but it was one expressed by one of the members of the committee.
Do I hear a motion?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes?
I'd like to move to refer to the Appointments Committee responsibility for drafting charges to the Family Fun Day Committee and to a Municipal Facilities Committee, and then report back to the council with those proposed charges.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any other comment? All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? Item 26, to consider referring a proposed wetland ordinance to the Ordinance Committee and take any necessary action.
We have somebody from the public.
Oh, excuse me.
We're not used to people from the public.
No,
Mr.
Taylor.
I, as you know, am a frequent participant in the process that this regulation is designed to regulate. And I have had an opportunity to read draft 16, not draft 16A, but I think that my comments are still pertinent. And they are that I think in the town council's referral of this ordinance to the proposed ordinance to the Ordinance Committee, if they so decide, they might charge the Ordinance Committee with a few specific responsibilities. And one of those is the question of the technical, an examination of the technical basis, and I think that this can take the form of a presentation by the people involved in drafting the ordinance so far, for some of the requirements in here. I have what I consider to be a fair amount of familiarity with these issues, and based on the ecological and physical processes that go on, some of these requirements don't strike me as reasonable. But the people who have drafted the ordinance may have reasoning that I don't understand. And secondly, I would recommend that that this ordinance appears to me to take in a great deal of the area of Cape Elizabeth. And the council might consider having a plan drafted showing the town and delineating on that plan the areas that would be subject to regulation under this wetlands ordinance. If it turned out to be a third of the town of Cape Elizabeth, I think the council might want to consider very carefully whether that much of the town needed to be subject to this kind of regulation. A couple of smaller points. The role of the Zoning Board of Appeals often becomes a question in an ordinance like this where there's no mention of it, and that might specifically be included. Another issue is that there are existing subdivisions where these wetlands issues have been considered, and one of them is my subdivision off of Shore Road, where some of the lots would be rendered unbuildable or severely restricted by the restrictions in this ordinance that are substantially different from the restrictions in the existing ordinance. And a great deal of time, thought, and attention was given to regulation of activities near wetlands in the review and approval of that project, and I'm a little surprised to see that the recommendations here come out to be much more severe than those that were tested in a more public arena. And finally, I think the town is a participant in litigation now over wetlands regulation issues, and that may have some impact. And all I'm trying to say is that the Ordinance Committee has many issues to consider in reviewing this particular proposed ordinance.
Excuse me, could you clarify your next to the last point again about that, which forum, I mean, you said it was in the public forum, was a...
In front of the Planning Board and the Conservation Commission, and also in terms of public forum and in terms of regulatory process, but not quite so public, in front of the DEP and the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers and the United States Environmental Protection Agency. The project that we recently obtained approval for and that you considered some easements for tonight, it was decided that that 50 and 100-foot buffer strips were appropriate for limitations of development near to wetlands. This particular ordinance concludes that 100 and 250-foot buffer strips are appropriate. The technical testimony that we presented in the licensing process indicates that 20 feet does the job in very many ways. So my concern here is that having gone through a rather thorough process and arriving at 50 and 100-foot limits on a project and planned the project around those 50 and 100-foot limits, to have 100 and 250-foot limits appear at this point might very well make the planning process that went on invalid. And once you've built the road, it's very tough to change the plan.
Thank you. Councilor Matheson?
You would be grandfathered, wouldn't you?
There's no provision for grandfathering in this ordinance.
No, but I mean, well, I think legally.
Well, I'm not quite sure if I may. For instance, on a particular lot, you are in the Dyer Pond project, you can make no alteration to the surface of the ground within 50 foot of a wetlands limit. And within 100 foot of a wetlands limit, you need to go to the planning board and get a special permit. If that were increased to 250 feet, which it would be under the terms of this ordinance, there are some lots where you would only have a very narrow strip where you could put the house, and some lot and major portions of lots would be rendered unbuildable. And the routing of the road through the project and the whole planning process evolved around the 50 and 100 foot limits I just described. And I'm not sure that somebody coming along to build a house on an existing lot after the passage of this ordinance would be grandfathered. I certainly would be grandfathered for my construction activity of the roads, but I'm not sure that a future home buyer would be grandfathered.
Anybody else got a comment? Thank you. Maybe Council Freeland is the chairman of the Audit Committee, and maybe Wayne, you would like to sit down and hear some of his points before you come to the Audit Committee and just give some thought and save some time in the public hearing.
Well,
we're interested in hearing.
Sure. We, a variety of us, met last year with the Joint Conservation Commission and Planning Board one evening. I guess we were at 15 that night. I'd be more than happy to do that, and I'm sure the co-members of the Ordinance Committee would be happy to do that also, and perhaps with the current representatives of the Planning Board and Conservation Commission would be a much more worthwhile evening. I think it's a good recommendation, Bill.
I think that your opening remarks is something that I had in my mind after going through this roughly and not quickly, because I think it took in a good part of Cape Elizabeth, if you go by the letter here.
It's my impression.
Yeah. Anybody else got a comment?
Just very briefly on that last point, I did discuss this with Dr. Rand today, and he and Steve Butler will be meeting within the next week, I believe even tomorrow, to try to update the wetlands map. The second wetlands map that still hasn't been approved yet has a number of errors in it, and to try to come up with the map that will be used for this process so that when you review this ordinance, you can understand exactly the lands that would be affected. Again, I would like to emphasize, too, that this draft that you have before you, 16A, has not been finally approved by the Planning Board and the Conservation Commission. This has been going through the process for about three years or more now. We've spent, I would guess, $10,000 or more on various drafts by consultants over the years. And I've been concerned for some time that with that sum of money being spent, it ought to be before the policy-making body of the community. And I would hope that the ordinance committee would invite the Planning Board and Conservation Commission to continue to work on a little bit while you're undergoing your review. They may be sensitive to the fact that it is at this point now, and I know they are, but at the same time, I felt it was important to get it before the council after 3 years of work and to get the thing moving along.
Thank you. That's a good point.
Michael, what are their plans for this?
I spoke to Steve Butler today, and the Planning Board has a very light agenda coming up this month. I believe it's next Tuesday night. And he was going to speak to Chairman Guthrie, Marion Guthrie, to see if she might schedule it as a workshop at their meeting next Tuesday following their other items.
Anybody else?
I have a question about the time frame we're looking at as a council. We're sending this to ordinance committee, and how long we can envision it staying in our ordinance committee. I'm very concerned about the length of time it's taking to get this ordinance on the books.
You asking the ordinance committee chairman?
Anybody who wants to answer.
Well, we are not planning on taking it up at our July 18th meeting. We have three other ordinances. We are taking it up, but if preliminary ground can be accomplished between planning and conservation, I don't think it's unreasonable to try to get it back to us within a 2 to 3 month period. Is that unreasonable? Type 4 month?
4 to 5.
I'll certainly go with the manager's recommendation of a 4 to 5 deadline to get it back here in hopefully final draft form.
Yeah, I'd be really pleased if we could have it back here in January 1990, which I think is feasible.
With the kind of money that we spent on it, it should be immaculate.
In gold.
Yeah. I would just like to ask you a question, Mr. Manager. You said they were putting together a map. The map they're putting together or updating, does that fit this draft, or does that fit what we have now?
The map fits the wetlands on the land of Cape Elizabeth. And it does define, within it, it is color-coded to define critical wetlands in the definitional terms of this ordinance. So then
if we change the ordinance in the ordinance committee or through the process, then we've got to come up with another map if they change the boundaries a little bit?
The map, the wetlands map in this ordinance should be reported back to the council at the same time.
Well, what I was trying to get away from, seems like you want the ordinance and the numbers before you come up with a map, so we don't have to spend the money to keep updating a map every time we change the numbers in the ordinance.
Well, you know, you can't change the wetlands, you know, by map. The map ought to show the wetlands. And then, you know, it does, you know, give them certain ratings, and then I think it really then ties into the ordinance and, you know, how you treat the different classifications of wetlands. But, you know, the map ought to be accurate no matter what the ordinance finally says.
As far as the type of wetlands?
The type of wetlands.
Okay. Councilor Kovachal.
How would the determination of the actual wetland area being done on site, are they actually tromping through all these areas to make sure that they have the lines in the right places?
Someone did that a number of years ago, and the cat and nine tail symbol on the map is believed to be accurate. It's some of the other areas that are less so, particularly with the scale. The primary source that Dr. Rand and Steve plan to use is the Cumberland County Soils Map, which for the most part is accurate, with the exception of filled land and some changes since the map was first put together. But, you know, no map is going to be perfect.
I was just going to say to you, Chairman Jordan, that one thing they could consider doing is doing an overlay on the map, just put wetlands on the map, do an overlay with the setbacks, and that has to be changed. It'd be easier than doing a new map or erasing.